Hi, I'm Mike. Today we head out early. We're going to help calves be born, and we're going to take a look at the technology behind calving as we go new school and old school on Our Wyoming Life. Welcome to Our Wyoming Life. It's 4 a.m. here on the ranch, and that's when my day starts nowadays. Over the past month or so, we've been calving our heifers, and now that they're winding down, we're all set for the cows to go into labor and bring their babies into the world. If this is your first time here, please subscribe and come along with us as we explore the ranch life and escape the ordinary. And if you're coming back, thanks for being a part of our awesome community. Heifers are first-time moms, and they require quite a bit of monitoring during the month or so that they've been calving. They're inexperienced in the process, and sometimes they don't even know that they've had a calf, and that's why we keep a really close eye on them. We have to make sure that they accept their calves, that they can take care of them, and that they're able to have them safely in the first place. With the heifers winding down, things are getting, well, not a little bit easier, but by no means is the struggle of calving over. We still have over 150 cows to go, and now begins the long calving season on the ranch. Cows still need somebody to watch over them, and we need to make sure that calves are born safely and that they're healthy. We tag babies so that we can keep track of who's calved and who hasn't, and we're also able to reunite lost calves with their moms. Checking the cows is an all-day-long process. They don't clock out for me at 5, and I sleep when I can, checking them every few hours. Our first years here, however, well, they were tough. I didn't have a clue about cows, the calving process, or how cows would react when they got their calves tag, and most importantly, I didn't know the early warning signs of trouble. Believe it or not, I got this book. This is Raising Beef Cattle for Dummies, and started learning everything that I could about cows, and soon I did feel more confident and sure in my abilities. But as with anything, there's always room for improvement, and that one thing that really hasn't been incorporated well into ranching is technology. And I get it. There's an old romantic notion of following your cows on horseback through the hills and valleys, sleeping under the stars, falling asleep on your bedroll, listening to the cows lull you to sleep, I guess. It's cool. But this is also a business, and just as in the late 1800s, the repeating rifle was huge technology and new technology and helped protect herds all across the West, now new technology is emerging for ranchers and cows and calving. As we get ready to head out this morning, we're going to use some of that technology here on the ranch. We've got a thermal imager, spotlights, and tools that help make things a lot easier. But just like the ranchers in the past century, it all comes down to knowing your cows and knowing what to look for. It's dark out here. Without lights, you wouldn't be able to see but a few feet ahead of you. No street lights to light our way, no glowing sign from the Holiday Inn to light up the countryside. On the bright side, so to speak, it's a great place to go stargazing. But it's horrible conditions to try to find a single cow somewhere in about 400 acres. She's out there, and tonight it's our job to find her. Luckily, we have the tools to do it. Most of our night checks are done in the John Deere Gator. It's got an enclosed cab, not only to protect us from the weather, but also from an angry mom, or to make a good place to get a calf in and warming up if we have to take him back to the barn. On top of the Gator is a spotlight. This is a Go Light radio-controlled spotlight. It's got a 200,000 candle power bulb, and it'll shine out about 300 yards on a clear night. It features 370 degree rotation as well as tilt, and it's invaluable for searching for calves or cows at night. Using the remote from inside the Gator, I can aim it exactly where I need it. The only problem being, where you aim it is all you see. You have to keep moving the spotlight constantly to find what you're looking for, and that's where one of our newest and most expensive and most important pieces of equipment comes in and helps out. This is a FLIR thermal imager. It's a Scout 3. This one sells for right around $1,400, and there are versions that are less expensive. We look at it as an investment in the ranch. If you save 2 calves with this device, it's paid for itself, which it already has. The unit features different settings for viewing heat, and we can switch it on the fly depending on current conditions. Some settings work better in snow, some in fog, and others even better in warm weather. The best way for us to use it is to find a high vantage point and scan the pasture. Most cows will hang out together at night, but a cow that is in labor or recently calved will tend to separate herself from the herd, sometimes even hiding to have her calf. The higher we are above the pasture, the better. And once on a small hill, we can take a look across 400 acres all at one time, looking for any hot spots out in the field, just like this one, a small dot. It's something giving off heat, and it's located about 2,000 feet from where we're at this time, or a third of a mile. Now I'd bet dollars to donuts that it's a cow in labor. Heading that way, we can use the FLIR thermal imager to keep our bearings until we're able to get a spotlight on the cow. This is number 65. She's 7 years old, and this will be her sixth calf that she's had on the ranch. By checking our records, I know that she's never had any calving problems or complications, and with the sun beginning to rise, apparently her labor isn't too intense because she heads back towards the cows and the rest of the herd. We're all waiting for breakfast, and I'm nothing if not a good server, so we roll out a couple of bales of hay for them and get their morning meal out of the way. We're expecting temperatures into the low 50s today. Lows at night are still dropping down into the teens, but once the sun shows up, man, it feels good. Another piece of technology that we have at our disposal is the MooCall. This thing is really cool, and it could help you out with your prize cow or heifer if you've got her in the barn, you're waiting for her to calf. The MooCall costs about $300 and includes your first year of service. Additional years of service cost about $120, and here's how it works. Cows are crappy poker players. They have all the tells, not when they're holding a good hand, but when they're in labor. And over time, you can learn to spot them from a long way away. The MooCall takes one of the cow's tells and translates it into digital signals, and that tell comes from the cow's tail. When cows are in labor, they're going to swish their tails around, and the closer they get to having a calf, the more they're going to do it. By strapping the MooCall to a cow's tail, it'll measure the movement and look for that sweet spot, indicating looing birth. When it gets those signals, it texts your phone. That's right, you get a text, a butt dial from a cow, telling you that you had better get out and check on her. It's amazing, and it works really well. We haven't had a chance to use it yet this year, but we used it last year and it worked great, and I look forward to using it again this year as well. With the cows fed and an hour or so gone by, we can now go back out and check on number 65 and see what she's doing. We know she's going to have a calf today. The question is when. But how do we know she's going to have a calf and doesn't just want some alone time? The tells I told you about earlier are easy to see once you know what you're looking for, and some you can spot from all the way across the pasture. And the easiest to see is the tail position. Not only does a cow hold her tail up to give birth, but her pelvic ligaments are going to loosen up, preparing to give birth. Another tell is mucus and discharge. The closer they are to giving birth, the more there's going to be. In addition, you can look at a cow's udders. The closer she gets to calving, the more full and solid it will look as the milk comes in, preparing to give her calf its first drink. Another indication of labor is little feet. Calves are born feet first. Their nose will normally slip out after their feet and it's wedged between their legs, and the rest of their body will soon follow. When we see feet, we expect to have a calf within the hour, and if we don't, then we have trouble. It could be stuck or even a breech calf. Our girl, number 65, is close, and we're going to give her some privacy and check another cow just down the hill who looks like she snuck under the radar and had her calf within the last hour or so. Looking back at the FLIR footage from this morning, I can actually see where she was. I looked right over. There she is. See that little dot? Luckily, she looks like she had her calf just fine. This is one of Gracie's cows, and the calf gets a pink ear tag, Grace's color. Now, I've had some people ask me how I can keep the cows calm when I mess with their calves. And honestly, I don't know the exact answer. These cows are very used to me being up close and personal with them. When I feed, I get out of the tractor and I'm right up with them as I cut the net wrap off the bales. I walk through them while they're eating, and I guess they just trust me. They know I'm not there to hurt anyone or anyone's calf. But they also know that I'm the boss. When it's time to sort or move cows, they know when I say go, they go. And they can argue, but they're gonna lose. So it's 95% trust, 5% fear. That's my guess anyway. With Grace's calf tagged and ready to go, we can now go back up to number 65 and take a look and see what she's doing. We're getting close, and now it's nothing but a waiting game. She's been in labor for so long, and we're gonna keep a pretty close eye on her and wait for this calf to be born. Eventually though, the time is coming close. In an effort to gain herself some privacy, she's gonna leave us, and we're gonna back off, giving her some space, but keeping her in sight. When she lays down, well, then it's go time. We can swoop in. Not taking all the credit, but hey, we're here. This little boy makes the 23rd calf born this year on the ranch. And as each calf is born, the future of the ranch is carried along with them. We do this not only for the love of the animals, but also for the love of our family. To be able to offer them the life that we lived, the lessons that we've learned, and the experiences we've been through. Ranching and farming is all about legacy and using technology. Learning new ways to do things is a part of a legacy that I hope that I can pass on. But as with any technology, you can't forget the ways that our grandparents and our parents did it. When the electricity goes out, we still reach for candles. And imagine what would happen if you didn't know how to light it. Reading cows' signals, knowing their behavior and what is normal and what is not, is sometimes the best tool you can have in your toolbox. That and common sense. And the ability to walk on your own.
Thanks for coming out with me today. Subscribe and join us as we continue to explore the ranch life and escape the ordinary 3 times per week right here. Find us on Facebook for content that you can't find anywhere else, and hit that like button if you like what you see. I'll talk to you in the comments, and until next time, have a great week, and thanks for joining us in our Wyoming life.
I didn't have a clue about cows and the calving process, how calves would react to getting their calves tagged. Nothing but a waiting game. She's been in labor for so long, and we're gonna keep a pretty close eye on her and wait for this calf to be born. Eventually though, the time is coming close.
Thanks for coming out with me today. Subscribe and join us as we